Order the meeting of the Raleigh Planning Board for Wednesday, March 30th, 2016.
So moved.
All right, so.
All those in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, so the first item we have on the agenda tonight is a public hearing. We have a request to amend the zoning map to transfer a portion of 420 Newburyport Turnpike from the outline district to the light business district. So the first thing I need to do is read into the record the notice. Pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 40, Section A, pardon me, 40A, Section 5, the Raleigh Planning Board will hold a public hearing on Wednesday, March 30th at 8:00 p.m. in the meeting room number 5 in the Town Hall Annex Building located at 39 Central Street, Raleigh, in regards to amending the zoning district map of the town of Raleigh, the map to transfer the portion of the parcels herein described by the outline district, from the outline district to the business light industrial district, consisting of approximately 10.74 acres and incorporating the following areas. A portion of 420 Newburyport Turnpike, Raleigh Assessor's Map 18, Lot 3, consisting of approximately 2 acres, and a portion of 428 Newburyport Turnpike, Assessor's Map 18, Lot 3-1, consisting of approximately 6.5 acres, and a portion of 344 Weathersfield Street, Raleigh Assessor's Map 18, Lot 5-21-1A, consisting of approximately 2.3 acres. The subject properties are currently owned by 420 Newburyport Turnpike LLC. The proposed amendment to the zoning map, changing the zoning from outline district to business light industrial, would eliminate the current split zone condition of the subject parcels. A map depicting the boundaries of the proposed amendment to the zoning district map of the town of Raleigh depicting the zoning areas on the subject properties being transferred from the outline district zoning to the business light zoning district may be inspected at the planning board office at the aforementioned address during regular business hours. Any person interested or wishing to be heard on the zoning proposal should appear at the public hearing at the time and place designated. So we have the petitioner.
You're here.
You're here, if you wouldn't mind stepping forward, we're going to just, I think we know what we're doing, but I think for the purpose of the public hearing and getting you on the camera, they want you to, we wouldn't mind coming forward.
I can actually.
You want to do the honors?
Sure.
We'll both come.
Good, terrific.
Kurt, all you have it in the zoning.
Kurt, do you have a copy of this on your computer?
No, I don't have the, I don't have the color on the computer. This is what I had, was that it was black and white. And so I just, I highlighted it just to, you know, but we can use this.
You can have this if you'd like.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I've got.
We chose it to make it easy to look at.
Yeah, no, I got the large copy, I just didn't have a color copy for this. But, I mean, I took the same copy, but it was black and white. It shows up black and white because of the print.
Okay, but probably depicts the same thing without.
The lines are all the same, nothing changed from last.
Yeah, that's the official map, I just wrote over it.
Gotcha.
You know.
Okay, so I know that we talked about this once before, but because we're here for the public hearing, if you wouldn't mind just summarizing what we're trying to do here.
Brian and Sandy Patrickin, the two petitioners. This is 420 Newburyport Turnpike, the 2 acres that we are requesting to be rezoned are highlighted there in the light green, following that line. That is the zoning line as it currently exists. 428 Newburyport Turnpike, which is on this side. This is the approximately 9 acres in the dark green attached for that area there, existing zoning line. So that's straightforward.
Very good, and so you're asking us to move back the zoning line, or asking the town to move the zoning line back so that your, the commercial property is all zoned the same?
Yes, please.
It moves it back to what will then be the property line as it walks around this pink.
Which is the property line?
Right here. And that'll be the new property line.
And not associated with this warrant article, but a separate.
A separate matter, right?
A separate matter is.
The pink.
Some of the open space and wetland areas to be donated to the town of Raleigh.
Yes.
And that's in the pink.
That's the approximately 23 acres.
In the pink, yeah.
Everything there to be donated to the town under the provisions of the Conservation Commission.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, and then out here is, this is all Girl Scout camp.
So it's contiguous to the Girl Scout camp, right?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
And whereby creating a buffer between the town's property and your light industrial property, and which is probably not even necessary, but I think a great idea.
Yep.
And something the town will benefit from.
For the future, I think it also clarifies any future sale of the property as well.
Yes.
From title purposes, right?
Sure.
And the property is held as two different, separate parcels, so that's why there's two separate shared areas.
Exactly, the hatched and the green.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not all 420 Newburyport Turnpike LLC?
The LLC, what Sandy's indicating, two different addresses, 420, 428. This was all required as we expanded by the 911.
Right.
Having, because there's two separate entrances.
Yeah, they're part of like three different parcels. That, this long one here to the west is 344 Weathersfield.
Oh, I
see. It has its frontage on Weathersfield. And then the other two are the 420 and then 428. So if you read the legal description, those three different portions are called out.
We acquired this property in several transactions.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you did.
We started here, then we bought this, then we bought that, then we sold that, and then there's two parcels all back in.
Do any of the abutters have any questions?
I was about to mention that it is a public meeting, but and yet it doesn't seem to be that there's anyone here in opposition or support for that matter. But for that reason, is there anything that the board would like to comment beyond what we've already discussed on this?
No, we've heard this before in informal hearing.
Can I also just point out the other portion that we're going to talk about, that there's going to be an A&R portion of this, because the 344 Weathersfield, which you recently acquired, you're going to like give a portion, the western portion of that, or donate that to the town, but there's going to be a smaller portion that you're going to retain.
Correct.
That
this portion of it here is being donated, yeah. And there's a chunk of it right here.
Yeah, which that's what I was trying to demonstrate.
That's being reconfigured.
Which makes sense.
In this section up here, the hatched portion is the portion that's being donated. Or, I mean, that's okay. Being retained.
It evens off the commercial use, you know?
Correct.
Yeah. So that portion that's hatched is going to also, it's going to be rezoned, is part of this rezoning as well. So it goes from OD to BLI as well. So there, later tonight, we're doing an A&R in which that portion is merged with the rest of 428 and 428.
Which is being rezoned with 420, parcel of 428.
Yeah. It's that section right there, and it's delineated clearly on the A&R.
Yeah. All right, very good. I think we'll deal with that when we deal with the A&R. But okay, so any questions? So at this point, you're asking us to endorse this plan for the town meeting, right?
Yeah, to endorse the amendment to the zoning map, which means that the portion that the zoning line on their property is going to be transferred from outlying district to BLI, business light industrial.
And so we're voting to recommend this article.
Article 2 to mm-hmm. town meeting.
And this precedent for this too.
Yes.
Okay. So at this point, given that there's no public comment, do I have a motion?
And no written comments either, Kirk?
No.
Okay.
Make a motion that we approve the proposed article to change the zone.
Or approve it for recommendation.
Recommendation.
All those in favor?
Aye.
No, somebody's second.
Oh,
second. Okay.
David, motion. Curtis, second. Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. Okay.
Thank you.
And the way our calendar's working today, we have somebody coming at 8:45, but we've got the opportunity to maybe move that A&R up at this point. So I know that's related if you're here for the same purpose. So
certainly.
Is that
the A&R?
This is.
Probably easier to roll it right over on top of that one.
Thanks, sir.
Ooh, great stuff, huh? Yellow.
Wow. There you go.
You gotta sign that puppy, huh? Oh, the overlay, nice.
What this shows is that this section here, which we just delineated as the area that's being rezoned. Yeah. This is the area that's being rezoned. So we're taking a portion of that and bringing it into this lot. So this shows here the section that's coming out and then showing what will be left.
And that's the frontage that's over here.
Yeah. So essentially, right. What will be...
Yeah, nothing is changing in terms of 344 Weathersfield frontage.
No, it's really just this area here. So what it ends up with is that becomes part of 420 and the zoning, okay? The requested zoning change. And then we end up with three lots, this parcel A, lot A-2, and lot 3, which is what we are also suggesting that the town accept that as the donation.
Okay. This clearly delineates
everything.
Yeah, this lot was created by us a few years ago.
I remember that.
Mm-hmm. And it was done with the intention of giving that lot to the town. We just didn't own the rest of it at that point. Over the last couple of years, we bought out the two neighbors that were there.
And this is primarily, this is wetlands?
Yes.
And bordering vegetated wetlands to Bachelor Brook?
Yes, the brook's way over here.
The brook is delineated right here.
And this was that property you were kind of maybe opening up some of the drainage, maybe, or proposing to?
Correct.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, there's a driveway there that we're going to remove. We agreed to remove it.
That's delineated there, and we'll take that out.
And there was, there used to be a house there.
A house.
There's two houses.
Two houses.
It was up here.
Yeah.
They were that far?
Yeah. There was a house here.
It's been a long time since I've seen those houses.
The two houses were right next to each other. I mean, within 30 feet of each other.
No kidding. I forgot they were that far in. They are pretty far in.
Is that portion, it's being merged in with 420?
428.
Yeah. 428.
Yes.
Okay.
420, 428.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And you're grateful that you didn't see one of those houses.
It's been a long time. I remember, we actually, the Conservation Commission, we actually approved those.
How much frontage do you have here?
So they kind of went into disrepair.
Yeah, so 26, 23, 10, so right there is just about 60. And then this,
wouldn't affect, because they're not losing any frontage.
They're not losing any, okay, right, so it's, exactly, okay, gotcha.
That lot is already established by the town, and there's a driveway, and what Sandy referred to, that's the driveway that we're ripping up at Brent's request, and then that is, because of the drainage down into the brook and the close proximity, we included that with.
Which is a good thing.
There's some culverts in there that he asked that we take out. So as we take the pavement out, we're just going to dig out the culverts too, which suits us nicely. It fixes his drainage problem, and it ensures that nobody's coming up the driveway.
Yeah, because it does, right, and also probably take out some old silt fence that never get taken out.
This is good for us. It's good for the town, and it's great and responsible for the environment, is what it comes down to.
Now, just the point in terms of the proposed use of the air, are you looking for to do anything with that area that becomes BLI or that's being incorporated? Is it going to become parking or?
We haven't made it that far. We want to see if it can get approved.
Okay.
And then we'll eventually do something with it. But to tell you definitively, this is exactly what we have planned right now. We haven't made it that far.
Okay.
That land is cleared now.
Okay.
This is the thinnest boundary between you and another property.
Yes.
Where's, is there someone live over here, right?
No, that's the...
No,
that's
this is the Girl Scout.
Oh, this is Girl Scout here?
Yeah.
This line makes sense if you were standing there looking at it.
Yep. Okay. I understand. Yep.
The elevation change from that line down to that brook is about... The 25 to 30 feet.
Yep. The houses are further up.
Right.
Yeah.
Are there any houses further up toward Weathersfield?
No. The closest house is Kurt
Turner.
Kurt Turner lives right there.
See, I was wondering where he lives.
Yeah. Just on the other side of the brook.
That's good for him.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Well, especially in terms of lot 3, it really gives a better buffer. Yeah. Okay.
What do we need to do?
That's going to the town.
This is for endorsement of the A&R, basically to merge. You're vacating those three property lines, so you're merging that portion of what was once part of 344 with 428.
428, correct.
Before we vote, just read it.
So this is just a matter of endorsement of a A&R.
Brian, I correct in saying this is already a standalone lot.
Correct.
That's a standalone lot.
Correct.
And the A&R is addressing creating or eliminating this lot line.
Yeah. Correct.
And combining those two.
Yeah, exactly.
Correct.
Yep.
All right. Well, any other comments we want to need to consider? Any other? All right. So what we're here to do is petitioner submitted an approval not required request for a boundary line modification to transfer portion of the land, 2.3 acres, from 344 Weathersfield Street, map 18, lot 5-21-1A, to 428 Turnpike, map 18-3-1. Want to take a vote on that?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye. Okay.
Was there a second?
I didn't hear one. No. I'll second it.
Okay. So, chairman motion, second by David. All those in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. All right. Good day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do we have to sign this?
I think we do, yeah.
Do you have a nice Sharpie? Do you have a Sharpie there?
Still got one. I have one of these.
That's a jump in.
It has to be something that was right, so it can be a permit.
This could do it, but if we got a Sharpie, that usually.
I have
Sharpies,
though. Yeah. Okay, I
now, what happens to the Mylar? Do we take that out of
gets
here?
It gets recorded.
Yeah, you'll need to record.
We need to record.
There's a 30-day. Is there?
It needs to be recorded, but you can. I'll send a letter, taking note of the endorsement to the clerk. She'll stamp it. You get that. Take it to the along
registry
with the
Okay, and we'll leave the colored drawing with you just for.
That's for the town meeting.
Yeah, but you take this and record.
But this will be what I guess I need. I might have drawn.
I usually have several.
Let me go get
Brian. You usually have a couple. We usually sign a couple so you can keep one.
Oh wait. Oh.
Is it your only one, Brian?
No, we submitted
right in front of you.
We submitted, I believe, three Mylars to you that came.
Well, one Mylar, and then we got
prints. We usually try to sign a couple, so you have a signed copy, which is a good thing for you for your record.
The other copies.
Okay, so we'll sign all three. This is the one you want.
Yeah, see, that's important.
That's the one that's going to go to the registry.
Yeah, it's important for you to have a signed copy.
Yeah, we keep a copy.
So you can't get it. It's hard to get the registry.
You have a copy.
Well, once it's all signed and stamped and so forth, if we get it, we'll just copy it.
In the meantime, we'll sign one for
that's right.
You want one signed for
you? Yeah, we need one for the file.
See, we want to sign a copy.
Where's the pen?
Right there.
But like if you ever transfer the property, like
and then once you get it recorded, just have it. Send back.
People are always looking
at absolutely. We're doing a bunch of recording stuff with what we're doing with Brent right now, too.
Okay.
So. That's not a Sharpie, but that'll do the trick.
Yeah. Somebody knows what
we should sign it. You want to sign the third one?
Yeah, I think it would be a bad idea to get a third one out there. So we
send that someplace.
All right, we got.
Everybody can get the sign.
That way you have one, we have one. And the registry details.
We did.
I see four signatures there, that'll do it. Oh, but yeah, this one I think is staying with us, right?
You can keep that one.
Okay.
And I still take that one.
Is that signed by everyone?
That one has got four signatures on it, yeah.
No, okay, you guys, here, David and Mark.
Yep.
Yeah, thanks. Of course, I'll go food.
Now, doesn't that Mylar have to go to the town, go to the clerk to be signed?
I'll write that letter. Oh,
it'll be done as a letter.
Yeah, and then you'll take a copy. In that letter, I'll let you know. I'll take your copy over to the sheriff's
right there, yeah.
And then you'll pick up that letter with a stamp. We'll take it to the registry.
Yeah, the only stamp that means is to certify the registered engineer's stamp, which you already have.
Yeah, I can see from here.
Is that Charlie, is that Charlie?
I think that's surveying.
That's what you need.
I'm leaving Mylar with you, or with, you taking that one?
But you need to get the letter from him before you record it.
Yeah, I'll send you that. Or I'll send it over to the clerk, and then you can go.
Okay, and...
And then once it's recorded...
Who has the third one?
The clerk.
I've got the third one.
You have the third one?
Yeah, so you get one, you get those two.
Okay.
I've already got the third one in the file, so that's out.
And doesn't it, you get a copy of that letter with the book and page back to you?
Yeah, I was just telling him, he'll...
See what I mean?
So I'll contact you, and you can let me know when that's ready, I'll come retrieve it, and I'll take it to the registry.
Okay.
And the registry will do it on the top, you know, the book and page, and then it's back to the...
Yeah, and we'll get it back.
So you're working with the Conservation Commission on the donation of the land?
Yes.
And where does that stand, if you don't mind me asking?
We hope to get it done by July 1st.
Terrific.
I think it'll be done.
For the tax year.
We have a few provisions on the land...
Corporate tax.
That we just want to have on the deed about not having any permanent structures, not having any trail easements on our side of the brook, so that we have safety concerns with people coming up into our operation area.
Sure.
Safety concerns, theft concerns, so we've, and not to put words in his mouth, but we more or less have an agreement with Brent on that right now, and now that this is really the first step in all that, we will now get a proposed deed over to him to be reviewed by the town council, so that that can all be ready in anticipation of the May date.
Town meeting.
Yes.
So it's all, it's in the works, the documents are floating around.
Got you.
So it's going in the right direction, and he has the plan that he requested.
Thank you.
Do we have a date for the May meeting yet, or will that...
I think it's actually, I'll confirm it, but I believe it was like May 2nd. You wanted to double check this with me, but I think possibly, I think it's Monday, May 2nd.
Monday, May 2nd.
And the election would be, what, Tuesday the 10th?
Oh, I don't...
The elections, yeah, I think it's on Tuesday after the meeting, yeah.
Okay, well...
So I'll confirm that for you.
And I'll be in touch tomorrow, thank you, everybody, for your time.
Thanks, everybody.
We appreciate the support.
Appreciate it.
Take care.
Have a good day.
Good night.
Good luck, guys. Take care.
Yep, bye-bye.
All right, so we've got...
Nice job.
Move that along.
Well,
I should have, like, set that second hearing for 8:30.
No, we're gonna do minutes right now.
Do minutes.
That's true, we got 2 seconds.
And where's Cliff?
I'm not gonna wait.
Did Cliff send in his... Did Cliff send in his changes yet?
Yeah.
No, he didn't say anything about it, so I think he's good to go.
I saw a lot of comments.
Any extra minutes? What?
Any extra minutes?
Oh, yeah, go ahead. I have my copy.
I didn't print out the agenda, but I did print out...
Look at me. Hey, put it up. We need his email.
Ones I just have to change.
Yeah, I miss coming around.
I don't want to mess up while you...
So we got February 3rd, and then...
Probably be previous.
March 2nd, so starting with the 3rd.
Can you, Kurt, explain what you mean here? Second paragraph, first page on the, it's March 2nd.
March 2nd. Second page, first paragraph?
Yeah, the planning board notes that the 2000, which we all recall, A&R plan did not acknowledge the private road to Boxford. You mean to private road connecting Boxford Road?
Yeah, that private roadway between...
It doesn't go to Boxford, which is a town.
Let's see.
He has meant Boxford Road instead of Boxford, that's all.
So would you say the private road connecting to Boxford Road?
Yeah, we're...
It's kind of like we're on a trail to Boxford.
Right, which is how it got its name, I suppose.
You're thinking like, where is it?
It's third sentence, second paragraph, please.
So it's paragraph...
No, not third sentence, third line.
The 2002, right to the 2002.
It's this section. It's like you get the A&R request, you on the right day?
The planning board knows...
Denny Travers one.
Notes that the 2002 A&R plan did not acknowledge the private road to...
Third line.
It's like a different form, oh, there it is, oh, it's a different form, I think.
Since Boxford.
I mean, what are you trying to say there?
It's right here.
Yeah, I read that.
Oh, yeah.
So So I think you mean private road, yeah. Boxford Road. Actually, in the same paragraph, and I think we, I, when I read through it, it gets clarified later. Mm-hmm. DeGrasso also presents a plan of land from August 1960 where a private road was created with the approval of the planning board.
Which we couldn't read, it was illegible.
Okay, you know what, I take it back, it says private road. Doesn't say public road, okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And also, Pierce, well, is there anywhere that Pierce noted that...
Larry?
Yeah.
Well, we all noted that it was very difficult to read.
That was...
Anything? On that 60?
Yeah, I guess I could put that in.
Well, because that was kind of one of the reasons why you asked them to maybe look for an original.
Yeah, okay.
So, why don't you reword this and bring it... I don't think...
I can bring it back next time.
Yeah, have them reword that just carefully, because that was a key point.
The fact that that map, that subdivision...
Because that was kind of the reason you asked for more research, and I think that's a salient point.
Yeah. So the 1960 subdivision plan was difficult to read.
Difficult? We really tried.
I don't say it was illegible.
Yeah, and we tried to read it. We just couldn't read it. Yeah. So we didn't know what the intent, we couldn't really figure out what, it was signed by some members, but it wasn't, we didn't know what it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you couldn't tell if it was a subdivision plan or an A&R.
And it's really up to the proponent to come in and ask how it's relevant to their petition.
Yeah.
You can't like make it up as you go along.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, this means.
Of course it means that.
Clear as day. Next time.
Is that all right, if you bring...
Yeah, no, I think that's... I mean, I think... Right, so besides, I think Cliff would certainly want to crack at that paragraph
okay,
as well.
Since I'm in his chair, I'll speak.
Yeah.
That he might bring up the same... I'll bring up the same things he might bring up for clarification.
Yeah.
Well, it's important.
Yeah, no,
because
I...
Of in kind of the
case...
It was important because of the disposition, you know, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it... Yeah. You know what? I may have gotten an earlier copy of your minutes... But in this paragraph entitled Annual Report Budget Fiscal Year 2017.
Where? Can you denote that, please?
Okay, so we're looking at March 2nd. One of the last agenda items was Annual Report Budget 2000. Right down here. So you get an incomplete sentence or an incomplete thought.
Right.
That's a fill in the blank?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
All right.
Oh, yeah, you're right, it does.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, that's another reason for maybe, like, revisiting.
Sure, we can take a look at it. We still got to look at the... Let's see if we can get the February 3rd
scratch off
the list.
And you thought that we'll be meeting, like, in 2 weeks, right?
Yeah.
Did you say we'd be meeting, like, in like 2 weeks?
Yeah, well, I'm going to suggest a date.
Why don't you do that now?
We do have another...
2 weeks is not good for me.
We're kind of freewheeling right now, so why don't you... Why don't we suggest a date, then we can...
We have another site plan review coming down the pike, so we might as well go on and set a date so I can target the public hearing for it. I was going to suggest potentially April... April 27th. April 27th.
27th, I could do. I can't do any.
That's
the 13th and 20th.
That's school vacation for you.
I'm going wrong.
I will be late for that
meeting.
We can always start it at the same eight at the public hearing at 8 o'clock.
You
take care of any business ahead of time and then hold a public meeting at 8 if you can be.
I believe the 27th works for me.
Okay.
Does that work for everyone
yeah.
else?
Yeah.
Does that work for you, Chris, or you're the chairman?
No, that's fine. That works.
I can make 8 o'clock if it's appropriate.
Okay. 8's good for you, David?
Yeah, I've got design review at 6 in Salem. So
that's cool.
Depends on what's on design review.
Did you take my agenda still? That's fine. I usually write down the next meeting the agenda. Do you?
I didn't take your agenda at all.
You did, because you were
doing some copies.
I did. That was my agenda.
Which is fine. I'm right here. Just keep it.
I'm happy to share it with you, but I've only got the one that I've started with.
That was my hand to you to read.
There's some stuff here.
You might be right. copyright.
So it's, do you need it?
Nope, I got my own.
All right, so the next meeting, Kirk, is at 8 o'clock, or 8 o'clock on the 27th?
Maybe on that one, we'd start to do all the business at 7:30.
Well, he's not going, but David's...
Yeah, but we'd have a, if there's a public hearing, I would hold it at 8 o'clock.
Okay. Is that okay with you, David?
Yeah, it's easier to make 8.
Pretty sure that Cliff...
See, the last Wednesday, I have design review on sale.
Public hearing is at 8?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure Cliff can make it.
I think, yeah. All right.
You know, if there's any problem with that, since we're saying that they're, you know, setting 8 o'clock, I can just shift it to 8 o'clock completely.
Well, we don't have to vote and say that's for sure. I mean, we can email. I mean,
call Cliff on his vacation.
Okay. You have his cell phone, right?
Yeah. I was talking
to him. Takes your phone on vacation?
He's here.
Everybody
I
know. I have to in case something happens. All right. David, you want to do the next minutes? Did you want to do the next minute?
It was the previous to February 3rd.
Oh, February 3rd.
I didn't have anything. I'm not the English major anymore.
That looked pretty clean.
Yeah, I thought that was good, too.
Okay, I make a motion. I'm going to sit here for a minute. I make a motion. They accept the...
Hang on one second. Wait.
Okay. I'm waiting.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Make a motion that we accept... Regular meeting minutes of February 3rd, 2016.
Can I get a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Yeah, those
unanimous.
Those are pretty straightforward.
All right.
With your report on the guards.
We still got 10 minutes.
You still got 10 minutes?
I do have, I guess first of all...
So I'm going to put redo on the...
If we can maybe, like, a timesheet and bill.
Sure.
I have a... The bill that I have is actually I paid for the certified mailing for the zoning amendment, and it was like 40 or 50 addresses. It's the only one I usually do because it's going to go to the Attorney General, and we want to be able to prove that we actually did the mailing.
Mm-hmm.
So
I think that makes sense. Yeah. Did you actually have to fill out 40 green cards?
I print out labels and stick the labels on the...
It's tedious.
Yeah. You have to do like several sets of labels, and you do it for the envelope, and then you do it for the...
Return, and yeah.
It took the poor guy at the post office. I did it last year, too, when we did the flea market. And that was a rather large one, too. It takes an hour for them to go through. In this case, it was the lady who works here.
Depends on where you were. You know, small
last year, it was like an hour.
Good. I thought you were doing this as a donation.
What?
You know why?
It's like expensive.
Is there that many land abutters and everything? Is that what that's interesting?
Yeah, there's that stack of.
How many abutters?
I think it was like about 40 or 50, something like that.
What was the location?
I'll count it. You probably have to count the stash, but it's all in that receipt.
Yeah, such big.
Where was it? Which location was it?
Kurska.
Well, for the tape switch bay. For that part, for those parcels around the...
How many feet do you have to go? 300?
No, you. It's a direct abutters and abutters within 300 feet. Of the
subject
shop or something. Yeah, well, that's what we did with the flea market last year. Remember, that was a big.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it was a large number of parcels.
Was Cliff given certified mail? Was he too far away?
I don't think he ended up on it.
Yeah, he's a little.
He's outside the street.
Yeah, but 300 feet. Never know.
In terms of housekeeping,
uh-huh.
Is it true that. In the last 24 hours, you have you respond to the first set of comments. Is there something you need to give us to read?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, I was waiting for
that. You could still give it to us while I'm here. Because that's just dead time anyway.
Yeah, you guys got the original, but I put all the comments in order. They're that app that I send you by email. But this is like all the comments, including the ones that John's response to Larry Graham's first submittal comments. And then also Larry's second review, which he turned around.
You don't need to talk about it. It's just housekeeping. Yeah, just housekeeping and handing out materials.
Can I also pass around the timesheet just?
Oh, sure. Please.
So do you have something? So what are you handing out? Is there something that wasn't in our packet is what I'm saying?
The newer comments. The one when I sent you the packet last week, it only had.
I just want to make sure I have what I have something March 2nd, then I have something March 18th.
Yeah, and this will go all the way up to today, to March 29th.
Oh, these guys here?
Yeah.
Yeah, the new.
All right.
And it starts with the earliest, March 2nd, and it goes to March 30th.
Yeah, well.
He's got all of them.
I figured, all right. The board might want to read that.
Yeah.
What's the date on this part? Wait, no, that's not right.
It goes from March 2nd to March 30th. They should be in order.
Oh, they're in order. Okay, yeah.
They dated more.
So really all I need is March. Page so much paper, man.
How many signatures do you need on yours?
Three on both on both sheets.
There you go.
Okay, awesome.
Tough one. Sure. I mean, there's no proof of these.
This would be a good time for a word from our sponsors.
I think we're just about there. Might as well give it another minute. But
I think you're okay.
since I didn't.
Yeah, and not visible from 133. But you're missing something here too. What's the criteria that makes it to? Am I missing something? Time.
Yeah, good. All right, well, we're going to move on to this next public hearing. We have an application for site plan review for the construction of a construction landscaping office and storage building to be located at 968 Haverhill Street, property owned by J.M. Dunn LLC in the Business Light Zoning District. So I'm going to read the notice. In accordance with the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 48, the Raleigh Protective Zoning Bylaws, and the Raleigh Planning Board Rules and Regs, the Raleigh Planning Board will conduct a public hearing on Wednesday, March 30th at 8:45 in the conference room at the Town Hall Annex, 39 Central Street, Raleigh, relative to an application for a site plan review for the construction of a construction landscaping office and storage building to be located at 968 Haverhill Street, property owned by J.M. Dunn LLC, TRS JDJ Realty Trust of 133 Bear Hill Road in Boxford. The subject property is also identified as Raleigh Tax Assessor's Parcel Map 4, Lot 18, consisting of 1 acre and zoned as Business Light Industrial. The proposed site review application proposes to construct a 2,400 square foot, 40 by 60 foot contractor's building that will contain a small office space and a garage storage area and a paved parking area that is also proposed. Approval of the site plan review application is required for the construction of the landscaping and office and storage on the properties located within the Business Light Industrial Zoning District. The application's plans and relevant documents pertaining to the site plan review application for the proposed building and associated layout are on file with the Raleigh Planning Board and are available for public inspection at the Raleigh Planning Board Office, Town Hall Annex, 39 Central Street, during public office hours. All right.
Is this for Gene? Right next to Saeed's son's, like, clear property. But next to Crystal Farm.
Why don't you go ahead?
Good evening. For the record, my name is John Moore, and I work for the Moore and Cameron Group. We're here tonight representing J.M. Dunn LLC for site plan review for their property located at 968 Haverhill Street. James Dunn is here tonight, owner of the property. So pretty much, Kirk's actually got the aerial on screen. This site is located on 133. As you're heading out of town, pretty much you're almost out of Raleigh at the time. Just north is 95, so it's just before you get out of town.
But before Mr. Abazara's property?
Yeah, before his storage property?
Yes.
Exactly. Actually,
and before the vacant lot next to his property?
That's actually right here.
Which is in between his property and your property.
And there's actually one additional lot between us and him.
But that, so that cleared property is near you.
Yeah, his cleared property is, if the cleared property
the
is
one not, for sale.
I don't know which one.
Well, one
is
for development. It's right next to his storage place.
You can see it on the aerial just above you, Jeff.
See how it's cleared?
Is that one, the one he's got the...
Yeah.
Is it that one?
For some reason it's divided. I thought it was a...
Yeah.
Okay, yep. But there's one in between, like you said, yeah.
Yep. So... what's on the property now, you can see on the aerial, there's actually two existing single-family dwellings located on this property. They're serviced by a gravel driveway coming off of the abutter to the east, and they're serviced by the gravel driveway that actually heads out to 970 Haverhill Street out back. So again, you get two existing dwellings. There's a septic system roughly right about here.
Hit me with the second one, it's serviced by what out back?
Well, there's an existing gravel drive that runs out back to 970 Haverhill Street. and there's an existing driveway that comes off into this property. So this property is serviced in two directions, neither across their own frontage. One is from the abutter to the north.
That's what I thought you said. Okay, yeah, okay.
And one is to the abutter to the west. But the main access...
Has it always been like that?
Yeah.
And deeded easements?
The...
Let me get ahead of the thing.
Right, we'll talk about that. Okay. There is an issue with the easement.
Yeah.
And I'll discuss that later. But the existing gravel drive, the main access to this site is through what's actually known as Lot 2, which is 970 Haverhill Street. And
we approved that a year or so. A
couple years ago through an A&R application.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Correct.
So,
good memory.
I mean, while we're talking about it.
You write the A&R, you write
the young guy.
That's the A&R. So back in 2013, September of 2013, they created lots 1 and 2. They actually proposed an easement at that time, access easement for the benefit of lot 1 to maintain that access that they already had. Well, when Mr. Dunn and Mr. Karpenko each bought their lots, they assumed that the easement was created because this record plan is referenced in both their deeds. What Larry had asked for is, well, do we have a record deed that was created for the easement? And from what we can find, there isn't one. So what we've done to this point is we've actually provided a letter that we had Mr. Karpenko sign today stating that I know there's an easement there, I'm aware of it, we actually thought it was already created, I don't have a problem with it. I'll do whatever Mr. Dunn needs for assistance in getting that easement created. So at this time, Mr. Dunn's talking to his attorney to have that deed created. It'll have to get signed off by Mr. Karpenko because it's across his property.
Correct, correct.
It'll just reference the exact same plan.
And record it.
Yep, and record it at the registry.
To clear up this title issue.
So they're working on that. Unfortunately, there's just no way to get that all done for tonight's meeting. So what I was going to ask from the board, if it is acceptable and they did move forward with any type of proposed approval, that it would be contingent upon a building permit not being issued until proof of recording of the access easement.
Okay. I'll give my opinion on that later. But keep
okay.
Going.
So again, right now, you've got two existing single-family dwellings serviced by a septic out front. We do have wetland resource areas to the rear. The 100-foot buffer is that area that you see in green. This entire lot's also located within the zone 2.
John, so, when was that flagged, John?
That wetland was flagged back in 2013, this portion, and then this September, the remainder of this wetland was flagged.
So that flagging has been accepted by the Conservation Commission?
Yep, Brent's walked it. We've actually had two meetings with the Conservation Commission already on this project.
In terms of a determination of applicability or notice of intent?
Notice of intent.
Okay.
So because of the fact that this site's located mostly in the Zone 2, pretty much you can see the only sliver is that little corner that's not in the Zone 2. We're also located
zone
in...
Zone 2, is that X thing?
Yes, this is the location of the Zone 2, yep.
Well, in essence, the whole thing is in Zone 2.
Right. So because of that, we do fall under the Municipal Water Supply Protection Overlay District as well. That also ends up, you have different criteria for your stormwater management when you're inside that jurisdiction. So what we're proposing is the construction of a contractor's storage building and associated contractor's yard, pretty much roughly in the location of where one of the existing dwellings was. We're trying to keep the structures roughly where the old structures were. One of the existing structures was existing non-conforming. That'll be removed. The proposed building conforms to zoning setbacks, so it'll meet all the requirements. Again, this is in the business light industry district.
But it's next to outline, right? There are residential outlying next to it, right?
Yes.
Which
right
is
here.
Right there.
Correct.
So your setback is what, 15 feet?
Yes.
Is That's the minimum.
Right.
Okay.
How many square feet?
So the edge of the building is right at the minimum.
Correct.
And the grading, well, keep going.
So 15-foot setback, and we're proposing a contractor storage yard that he would operate his facility out of, or his business out of. A proposed septic system would be in the front of the lot, as far from the wetlands that we could get it. It would be greater than 100 feet away. Based on the zone 2 and the fact that we have a lot that's 43,560 square feet, the existing use out on the property is two-bedroom dwellings, which is 440 gallons per gallons per day. The proposed septic would be based on 440 gallons per day. No increase in design flow. It does meet the nitrogen loading criteria for the zone 2 based on that fact, even though it's not an increase in flow. So we are proposing to maintain the access coming off of lot 2 because trying to bring the access in across this lot, it just doesn't work. You'd have to widen the access coming in.
You got that right.
And maintaining the existing gravel drive for a commercial development in the commercial zone with a property that's already commercial. So it didn't make sense to try to move up a access right next to the residential piece on that side. So we did soil testing out on the site.
It doesn't work from a business standpoint either.
Right. Well, yeah, it's located in the wrong spot and it just eats up too much of the property.
So are both the dwellings going to be gone?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. So groundwater on site, pretty high groundwater, great soils, but we have to deal with a high water table. Mm-hmm. Because of the fact that we got to deal with the stormwater management, one of the criteria that our client proposed originally, we looked at just proposing a gravel parking area and not doing pavement.
But that's not a good idea.
No, exactly.
There's too much hydraulic. You're going to have excavators and stuff parked out there,
yep.
Right?
And that's one of the...
There's no
trucks. But you have trucks. You have pickup trucks. You have dump trucks.
And there'll never be an there'll never be a machine out there.
No, I mean, there will be a bobcat.
There'll never be backhoes or anything out there. It's a landscape company.
Yeah.
So there'll be backhoes, and there'll be hydraulic air in zone 2.
Plenty of, yeah.
The hydraulic fluids, there's leaking diesel, there's leaking onto a permeable surface in a zone 2. Mm-hmm.
That's why we didn't propose that.
Exactly. There'll be no catchment.
So because of that, now the increase in impervious, we've got to meet the stormwater standards. So what we've done is we've proposed pretty much your standard above-ground infiltration for the majority of the facility. We are proposing underground treatment for the roof. It is clean runoff. However, since it is in a zone 2, you do have to treat that with different type of...
That's the least of your issues. You could drink that off the roof.
Right.
I'm more worried about the equipment.
Right. So as required under the standards, we have sand filters treating the roof runoff before it's discharged into a couple of infiltration chambers. And with regards to the runoff coming off the pavement, because of the fact that you have well-drained soils and you're in a zone 2, you have to meet 44% TSS removal before you get into your infiltration facility. So we actually have two sediment forebays designed. It'll treat the runoff before it gets into the actual infiltration basin.
You have nothing to slow down velocity for course and fines?
Well, they get slowed down in the forebays.
But there's no riprap?
Well, there'll be riprap between the forebays.
Okay.
So that's what separates the two forebays. So the slope coming across this parking lot is about a little over 1%. So you've got very little velocity coming across sheet flow anyway off this parking lot.
But it would all go into that?
Yes. It's all this runoff.
I'll be directing that.
All that runoff from the impervious surface is all directed into this first forebay. Correct.
Are there any impedances? Are there like, you know, you got to keep mulch or loam and all that stuff?
Yep. With regards to stockpiling.
That's what I meant. Where's the stockpiling area?
Stockpile would be right in this corner.
Which would be disrupting any sheet flow.
Well, water wouldn't even be getting to the pavement if stuff was sitting on top of it.
Yes,
so the only sheet flow that you would have is in this direction. So if the water got through the, like for example, if you had mulch on the pavement, the water gets through the mulch to the pavement. And then it runs under the mulch.
The mulch
would be
on top of the pavement?
Correct. Yep, so the stockpiled materials
on... But it's not going to flow off in the other direction.
Well, if it did flow off in the other direction, then it's flowing off the mulch. It's not flowing off the pavement. It can't flow off... Actually, it can't flow off unless the mulch is almost impervious.
I guess is what I'm saying. Is it going to be like, you know, blocked with cement blocks or anything?
No, the...
Or it's just going to be sitting on the pavement?
This edge of the parking lot as well... The way this is designed is this edge is all elevated so that it kicks the runoff back towards the forebay. So,
well, if you got a pile of dirt, you see what the state does. I mean, when you have a pile of dirt, it goes off in every direction. It's like a
right.
It's a mound of dirt.
So if you had water coming off of the mulch, that water wasn't in contact.
I'm talking
with the
about dirt, like loams, different loams.
He doesn't stockpile loam. The only material that'll be on site is mulch and grass clippings. That's it. He's not stockpiling loam. He's not stockpiling salt. He's not stockpiling stone.
But grass clippings are filled with all kinds of pesticides, herbicides, fertilizers, and who knows what other unknowns.
And that runoff...
Because you can't control what people use on lawns.
And the runoff from that would be heading into the stormwater system.
Well, this is okay, keep going.
Well, I guess my question is, so are you saying...
If
you're
piling, if there's nothing to contain the grass clippings, okay, let's call it a compost heap for that matter. Let's go to Georgetown, go to Mellow where they keep the grass clippings. It's all contained, you know? Or you go to what used to be, what was on 133 that used to sell mulch?
Midway.
Sell mulch, Midway, thanks. Yes, yeah. You know, that's also contained to some extent, you know?
Right.
It's blocked in. But if you just have a pile of grass clippings that go off, you have a slope there on that side of the property, correct?
Correct.
And that slope goes down, correct?
Yep.
So then you guys get the grass clippings that just kind of like go down the slope. How do you keep that? How do you maintain catchment across your what into your designed treatment?
Well,
you don't.
The runoff from the pavement would still go that way. The grass clippings falling off the edge.
Exactly.
Right, and what you're saying is the grass clippings are a pollutant.
Yeah, they are. That's why you can't put compost everywhere. You know that. In Hamilton or everywhere. Everywhere where there's compost, it has to be. There's rules about that.
Right.
You know that as an engineer.
So you just put cement blocks up?
There is an
issue. You can, but the issue is things, you know, in the winter, that's where snow stockpile for the plowing is in that corner. So you can manipulate and move the blocks around. So you're exactly correct. You could just set up the blocks on the back side.
Even that's not perfect.
Of this corner.
Or we could just not store grass clippings there at all.
I hate to say that, but it's just true. It's the truth.
Yeah, it's fine.
You know, you can't.
It's not a big deal.
It's a giant.
Like at the end of the week.
You know that. I mean, lawns are a giant source. If you look on a bag of Scott's, what does it say?
Yeah, it's got. I know, it's got everything.
It says don't even have it anywhere close to a water supply when you apply it.
Yeah, so we can solve the problem by just not storing grass clippings there.
But that's not good for you. I see why you want to have it. I mean, but
I can make arrangements to not have it. It's not that big of a deal to me.
But you know, it is in a zone two. Mm-hmm. And it's zone two by nature, as you know, we don't need to go into what zone two is for. Or maybe for the audience. The zone two is a watershed for the town water supply. And watersheds for the town water supply, typically in most towns and cities, are attempted to be protected in every way. The Cape, everywhere. That's why we designate it.
Right.
The source of pollutants need to either be attenuated and treated or else not put there.
Kurt, are you looking for some sort of barrier on that
All I ask for...
Face lift so the piles don't go over the edge?
I'm just saying, we can go into the whole stormwater management BMPs. But if you have something that's going to breach that or not work for it, then we need, that needs to be brought to the attention.
Because I can see where somebody doesn't know the rules and the pile gets over the edge and then...
Happens all the time.
Draining well, the other way.
Well, this isn't very far from the water treatment plant that we just put in for $14 million. It's diagonally.
I think there's been enough issues with town water to be as a board to be sensitive to any kind of contribution to that.
Right, and the concern is, and we understand the concern is exactly as you're pushing that pile or dropping that pile, you have the potential of that pile fluffing over the edge.
And there's absolutely no control as to what is in that pile.
Right.
We have no control over what homeowners use on their lawns. None whatsoever.
Well, and based on that fact, if we had a wall along the edge to contain it, would the board be okay?
Which is not waterproof.
Right.
You said it's only a 1% or less slope anyway.
Well, the wall, the grade, the way this is all graded, there's a berm on this side so that all the water from this gets pushed off in that direction. So the concern that I see with the stockpile in that area isn't the water running that way. It's the stockpiled material fluffing off in that direction.
Exactly.
So if we proposed a wall like the shade blocks along that edge, that would give you the protection that you're looking for, and it would give our client the ability to, you know, if he decided to do grass clippings here, he'd have that wall. If he decided he wasn't going to do grass clippings, then he wouldn't do
it. I'd rather stay away from it. I'd rather, there's enough issues with our zone 2 in this town in terms of a contiguous watershed protection area to try to do it right from the get-go. I don't want to inhibit anybody from using it, you know, what is in the commercial district for a good use. But it isn't a zone 2. And people, look, some towns don't even allow you to put anything in a zone 2. Nothing. They just keep it as a watershed protected area. In New York, you know, that's why the Quabbin is a huge area. Then no, you don't build anything unless you have a house there to begin with.
Right.
But if you tried to put this in, no.
Yeah.
It wouldn't even be entertained.
Well, and that's the point, is the property is developed. You know, the property's been used.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. So you're trying to redevelop it in a different way. That's
so do you have an issue with that, right? We just eliminate the grass clippings? I mean, we'll just take it right off the table.
I'm not trying to prevent somebody from using
the
property.
What was the other material, John?
Just bark mulch. And it's not colored mulch, it's natural mulch. He doesn't use any of the colored stuff.
I know where I was going.
Yeah, the dyed mulch. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we don't use
the dyed mulch
use
or
the
rubber mulch.
Mulch.
Right.
The rubber's made from hydrocarbons and old tires.
Right. So there'll be none of that. So the stormwater management system was designed in accordance with the standards. And again, the whole reason for the impervious, the pavement, was the point you had brought up, which was, how do you contain illicit discharges if it was gravel? So that's another reason why our client chose to go with the pavement. Plus, you know, maintenance, it'll be a whole lot easier in the long run. Mm-hmm.
What's the proposed square footage of the building?
2,400. It's a 40 by 60.
How many cars does it generate?
With regards to the proposed use of the facility, we can get into that. The inside of the building is an office, a bathroom, and a garage. The only thing in the garage is going to be the storage of tools, storage of plows that are taken off. He does plow in the winter, so he'll have a storage of plows. And he's got a sander, so the actual sander that attaches to the truck will be in the garage. And he does have one new truck that he bought this year that's only used in the winter. That'll sit in the garage. Other than that, there's really nothing else that's stored in the garage. You know, he's not storing a bunch of vehicles in there. He's got some leaf blowers that would be stored in there and some
typical
other...
Typical landscape items.
Right.
However, you have to refuel all these. I don't know, in your business, are there any...
I mean, we only fuel up at the gas stations.
No, but you refuel all your small equipment.
Yeah, I mean, everything's either...
Where do you store all that fuel?
Where do I store? In gas cans.
In the building?
No, a lot of it's in enclosed trailers, all ventilated.
In the trailers?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know.
That are in trail.
All you have is the trailers will be on the site parked.
Mm-hmm.
Would any light, any maintenance in the buildings?
No. All my trucks
small engine right maintenance or truck maintenance or sander maintenance or
no. I bring everything to mechanics. All my equipment's brand new. So everything goes to the dealer or everything goes to the mechanics that they use.
So there's no floor, there's no need for safety cleaner or other issues like you have in any of the other garages in town that are operating legally, you know, in terms of taking care of any kind of hazardous waste fluids.
Correct.
You wouldn't have need for that in your building?
No, because like I said, we don't do any maintenance on the stuff.
So the building has not been designed yet?
No. I mean, it's been...
He has pictures of it in the thing.
They're proposed pictures of not that exact same building. The actual size, the design is done, but the manufacturer hasn't been given the green light to move forward and actually put together the structural plans and the building inspector plans.
Just a big steel building?
Yeah.
I have with a cement floor? I could
put up a yes, line. Concrete floor.
Concrete. Cement is just a dust.
Like a foreign slab or something? I don't know. Well, John, what kind of slab do they put on these buildings?
School,
it's probably 8 to 12, I'm guessing.
8 to 12 rerun?
Most likely.
It'd have to be if that's thick. Okay.
So pretty much what I did is... You know, the manufacturer of the building obviously wouldn't put the building plans together without a deposit. Our client didn't want to spend that much money on a non-refundable deposit until he had a good feeling from the board that the project was going forward. So with the application, what we did is we asked the manufacturer, first they gave us a cross-section of the building that is correct, so we submitted that. And then we asked them to forward photos that they had of like similar structures.
Because I was going to say, that looks like it's longer than 60 feet.
Actually, that building's almost the exact same size. When we submitted that photo, we had a size on the top of it. That building's 50 by 60 by 16, so it's wider. But it's the same length. That's the length that our building would be, and the height's almost identical.
What's the height at the peak?
The height of the peak on that one, I don't know, but the height to the ridge is 16. To the height of the ridge on our, I mean, to the eave on ours is 17. To the eave on that one is 60. So it's almost the same height.
It's a full-size door with that extra foot.
Right. The length of that one's 60. The length of ours is 60. The width of that one's 50. So that one's 10 feet wider. And
the slope only gains you like 6 inches?
On that one, because they went with a real flat roof, we don't have that much of a flat roof. Our peak height is about 22 feet.
Right. What happened in this climate? It's better
yeah.
that way.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
so our building would be the front face would be a little different. We'd have
133.
A man door on this side, and then you'd have three garage bay doors in the front. You wouldn't have any windows, and you're not proposing any windows right now.
No windows.
And you may have one
no light,
or two.
No skylight, no light coming in that puppy. You don't know
yet.
You
basic,
might.
Yeah, I mean.
It depends where the budget is.
So in all the buildings, I got a couple interior photos. They're all clear span. So you maximize your amount of space inside. You know, he's looking at, you know, the siding would be gray with charcoal roof on it.
The gable end is facing 133.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. Kinda and there would be one door on that side.
There's some existing landscape there now.
David, you're being optimistic.
I mean, you go home that way. I don't.
The only thing that, if you call up that aerial, the one you originally had,
I got it.
There's one pretty much the only thing you got out front is...
No, not much.
A tree that's probably going to come down when we have to put the septic in.
One tree that's coming down.
Yeah, so there it's a willow, too.
So there should be some landscaping placed out there in the final plan.
Well, what we're proposing...
You can't screen that thing. You'll be seeing it easily. But how far out is the setback from Route 1?
From 133?
50. 50 feet.
Is that a relief? Kirk, were you saying something, 70 feet?
No, the 70 feet is the...
The 70 feet is the stuff that you stockpile.
That's right.
And the building, I spoke to the building inspector to get clarification on that, and he had mentioned to me that, no, the building itself could be 50 feet.
50?
Yeah.
So 50 feet from 133.
Yep. So what we're proposing for screening is actually a 6-foot-high stockade fence.
And a 22-foot building.
Well, you can't screen the entire building.
Exactly.
That's... And we're, again, I don't believe we're required to screen the entire building. We're required to screen... your stockpile material in your yard.
You're just required to do some landscaping.
You have to do some landscaping.
Landscaping.
I mean...
Well, we can...
And in your setback area, you're required to do some landscaping.
We can do some landscaping, but nobody will see it because we're putting up a 6-foot-high fence. So I don't...
Well, where's the fence going on 133?
Why are you bothering with
the
fence?
On 133, okay.
Because... in order to screen from the abutter on this side, the fence makes more sense than trying to get vegetation along that slope.
Well, that was going
to
be my next thing, because you know you have, you're asking for a waiver from a landscape plan.
Right.
Which is an added expense to get a landscape architect to draw up a plan for a site that doesn't really beget a plan, doesn't really work with it.
He's in the landscape business.
Especially, I thought that was kind of ironic.
Yeah.
Got the landscape rather than the landscape plan. But
again,
I understand why on this site.
The site doesn't promote itself to be landscape.
I understand
so.
On this site. Because you had some things in your original.
Yeah.
I said,
which, once they
I said to
up,
Kirk, great, there's 15 feet, there's a building, and there's an excavated slope, and you threw some shrubberies, you threw some trees in there. That's almost impossible, man. I mean, you barely have room for a fence.
Although I will say that
maybe a couple.
The building might, I mean, I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, but the building might be an improvement over the dwelling that's
oh,
there.
Absolutely. It most definitely
I
is. That property's been, you know, obviously just abandoned and let to...
Jean's like, she's such an optimist.
What? Couldn't you
Yeah, the reason why we
have landscaping along
the reason for that is once you grade for the septic, and we have usable space out in here.
Yeah,
you know, we originally were thinking of just running the fence along
this
edge.
That's what I'm thinking.
But you're eliminating this usable space that you have here.
What are you going to do with that?
Just
could be anything.
It could be landscaping.
But it should.
No, I mean we're looking at it for storage.
You gotta put some. You gotta have some landscaping.
Storage out front would be.
We have a problem with another building on.
You can't have the storage out front. Anyway.
Yeah.
It's gotta be 70 back 70.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you can have a picnic table out there. It's a little privacy, but.
I'd save on the fence and then. Take it across at the corner of the building. Let the building get a nice gray building.
I could see a fence for the abutter maybe. Or even an 8-foot fence. Oh, Ken, I don't think he likes. I don't think he likes 8-foot fences. He's 6. Ken doesn't do 8, right?
So really, what you'd want to do is run the fence all the way down to, I'd say, roughly about this point.
I mean, if I was a neighbor,
leave that open up front there, and then take the fence from the corner of the building over to protect you.
Look, we ran into this down in Saunders Lane, you know, with that Morton building, and people went nuts. You know, lack of state, you know, and this is really right up against an outlying commercial lot. I don't know who's there, but whoever's there now may not care, but maybe the next person, that's, I guess, the next person's problem. But I mean, you haven't had
well, the next person will know it's there because they move in.
Exactly.
Do you do.
But that doesn't make it necessarily.
Mostly maintenance, or do you do new landscape plans?
No, I don't get involved in plans, just maintenance stuff.
Okay, so it's...
You don't know anyone who does plans?
No, I do. I just... That's not my...
Because you implement the plan sometimes when you do projects, right?
Correct.
no one's willing to
conceptualize
anything for you.
Any signage going to, any labeling out there?
No, I don't want any sign if I don't have to.
You don't have to?
No, then no.
You can come back, I guess, if you don't want a sign?
No.
So John, you were talking about running the fence all the way down to the property line at 133, but then considering not running it back across the front of the lot?
Right. What we could do is run it to here, but then I just got to figure a way to block that view coming in.
That's fine, yeah.
I mean, I could run the fence this way, too.
Look, we don't have to solve it tonight, John. Look, we're getting, we don't,
yeah,
you know.
We're more worried about the runoff.
It's 9:20, and here we are.
I mean, I do think, though, aesthetically, from the perspective of people coming into town, it might be better to have something that has a little landscaping out front and a little more visually appealing and accomplish the shading in some other fashion.
They can always put the fence back a little ways just to have some shrubbery out front of the fence. You can have some shrubs.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, Mark should know about this. You know, he had an existing site.
No, privacy's in that. I know what he's looking at. He wants people to know. If people see things are there, then all of a sudden they're in there stealing at night and
back off the corner of the building.
Well, the fence, we don't need to decide the fence now.
You don't need to.
However, it is by bylaw that every commercial site is supposed to have some landscaping on a major highway. That's the bottom line. And that's what the bylaw
speaking,
says.
I'm in favor of the project.
Exactly, but that's not...
If we can only worry about the Zone 2, well, not only worry about the Zone, but the Zone 2 is a real... important thing.
I think John's heard that.
Well, it is.
Sure. I mean,
it is, especially for this use. You know? I'm not saying it's a dirty use. I'm not saying it's an especially clean use, depending on what's parked there.
And again,
like I said, all my trucks are brand new. All my trucks.
It doesn't matter. It's not. It has nothing to do with that.
How many employees do you have?
Nine.
And so 9 vehicles showing up every day?
No, they all... It's 4 usually, and then my own vehicle, because they carpool.
Uh-huh. You know, take one look in the TJ Maxx or Spuds or any parking lot, look underneath, look, just take a look at how many hydrocarbons run out. Take one look.
And again, you know, we were, you know, well aware of the Zone 2 and designed for that, and that's the reason why.
That's why you've taken up a good portion of what otherwise would be usable area to try to meet the stormwater management.
Exactly.
BMPs. And that's what I want to make sure. Maybe you can explain briefly before we, what does that mounding mean?
The what?
Educate me on your mounding calculations for groundwater.
The groundwater mounding?
Yeah,
what that is under the regulations, if you have less than 4 foot separation between the bottom of your system.
So that triggers it?
Excuse me?
That triggers it?
Yes.
Okay.
No, continue. That's only one thing.
Well, exactly. There's two things that trigger it. So... You got to meet, if you don't meet that 4 foot separation, under the regulations, you have to meet 2 feet. You have to have the 2 foot separation between the bottom of your infiltration system and the estimated seasonal high water table. If you are using your infiltration system to mitigate for the 10-year or the 100-year storm event, then you have to have either the 4 foot requirement to groundwater or you have to do groundwater mounding calculations to verify that during those storm events, the mounding beneath the system will not impact the system, or that the mounding won't all of a sudden break out of a slope further away. So usually when you're dealing with groundwater mounding near wetlands, you use your wetland edge, as that's that point that you're looking at, is the water going to pop out of the ground during that storm event because of the mounding. So Larry had asked for those calculations, and we had submitted those calculations to show that it didn't have an impact. And then Larry had asked that we actually reverse the X and Y dimensions of this ponding area here and verify that we still didn't have an impact. And we actually did those calculations today and provided those to Larry as well.
And then one last thing is in that mounting that you have the drawdown within 72 hours.
Right. You got to show that it still doesn't affect your drawdown. So all those calculations were done and submitted.
Okay. So that's why you have on your calc saying no breakout.
Correct.
Okay. But it's close.
I don't think it's that close.
Well, that's close.
71 to 68 point something? It's not that far. I believe. 69.42 to 70.
So at detention pond one, you're looking at like 69 and a half versus 72. So it's
2 feet.
You know, 2.5 feet.
2.5 feet.
For the infiltration trenches, it's 69.4 versus 72.5. So it's 3 feet.
So in your experience, that's...
That's more than that, but...
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, all the regulations want to show is that you're pretty much just not breaking out. They don't look for a separation distance, a required separation distance.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Thanks.
One of the issues, originally when we submitted the plan, we did not have a lighting plan. We had resubmitted the plans with a lighting plan on the second go-around, and we actually modified the lights a little bit. Originally, we had a spotlight on the side of the building, front of the building, and then a small light for the door on the side. So the plan that you see before you here, this is the very limit of the light that would dispense from that side door, the flood at the front of the building. And then we've got a different flood that sits up on a little pedestal to try to get a little more light off the back side of that, the contractor's yard. What you see in purple is the actual property line.
That's a single light on a pole on the building?
It's really not on a pole. It's just got a pedestal top, maybe about that high. And the light just sits up on the corner of that.
Are these LEDs?
I'd have to take another look at that.
Probably not.
I doubt it, but... But I can look at the specs on the lights and get that info.
And this one looks like an LED, but the luminaire.
Is that the
wall pack with the? So this is. It's got an LED in the code, but.
Yeah, and I'll check it. And the problem is the first set that we sent are different than the ones that are on the plan now.
All right, we'll just make the new stuff.
So I'll double check those and.
We'll have Kirk send us the new stuff so we can get rid of the old stuff.
All right.
What did you say? What's the pink line again?
That's the limit of the light. Okay. So we had them redesign it, and that's when we came up with the different lights to pull everything back and keep it off from trespass onto the abutting properties of the light.
That looks better for them.
Yeah. How many feet out are you trying to light?
Like as far as we could get.
No, I mean...
No, but stay on the property.
No, I mean like 50 or 100 or...
How far did we?
How far do you want to go? Because I put lights up on my new building, and they're like these little $100 LEDs. They almost look like they point straight down, because they have full cutoffs. But boy, $100 light, they go.
Yeah, the problem we were having though,
but it's still a cutoff light.
We were trying to light all the way to the edge of the pavement, but as we were trying to do that, it was just spread. In order to get that far, it's spreading out onto the abutter.
So yeah, Mark, you're not next to a residential area.
No, mine. You'd be surprised. It's like. It's just enough to walk around, but it's not. You're not going to work out there.
Zoning-wise, you're not next.
You're not next to a residential guy's house.
That's really.
He's got a bulb. Zoning board at the bottom line now.
Right.
I bet that because I went to this light nightmare. Like nobody can give me straight answers, and that's why I'm just these lights I put off. You ever drop there at night? You're gonna be. They're not bright. They're full cut off. They're LEDs, and they go. They seem to maybe go out like 50 or 70 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And that's about it. It just—it's like a line. It just cuts off.
Yeah, you know the LED.
To see them actually work.
Talking a lot like cutoffs are good now. You're right.
Yeah.
Would they be on all night or?
They'd be on motion, right?
Oh yeah.
On the diamond.
I was going to suggest that.
Yeah.
It's a program.
Yeah. You know what? The electrical inspector maybe could find on.
There you go.
The cells to turn on at night.
On he said electric bills. We just don't 21. See it. 21. Conservation.
Really? Yeah, because if anyone ever goes in there at night. And they trip and fall.
Yeah, that's good.
So it's not like
I don't know.
Easy decision.
It goes into a pool.
Yeah. Well, he can probably do what you want. He'll probably just.
Well, if they go there at night, they don't have any authorization to be there.
John, are there any other like Kirk? Are there any other big issues that need to be ruminated on before the next hearing?
Well, I think the The main thing might be to actually discuss like what you need in terms of the waivers, the architectural, the lighting plan you've submitted, so that's not really going to
work. Right, so really it's, we'll look at a landscape plan, and I think the only waiver would be the architectural, so we'd like to get a feeling from the board if they feel that the information submitted.
Do we need to vote, Mr. Chairman, on the waiver?
Well, we're only looking for one waiver now, right? So we need to discuss it, I think.
I think what he needs tonight is just a feeling from the board that the building...
Yeah,
we're going in the right direction.
Going in the right direction.
Yeah, because I still have a few
I have some.
I want to see the parking spaces laid out. And
Kirk, can you just tell me what the... we're looking for a waiver of the architectural requirement. What specifically are they... How far off are we?
Well, I think what we have is a sample building, sample drawings. It's like... but whether or not we actually have drawings,
architectural.
We've run into this before with Doggy Jim on 133, the big steel building there.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Right.
We got into the drainage there and landscaping and setbacks.
Yeah.
For the neighbors versus the actual, we even got into it with Mark. You know, we got a concept with Mr. Savory's building.
Right.
You know, I know we had this discussion.
It wasn't like an arch. He gave us some elevations. He gave us the same amount.
I'm learning the same thing he did, though, like, because they won't really give you a picture on all these things until you give them a deposit. And, like, you don't want to give you no $30,000 deposit and get it back because it's something in terms of books. It's like, on his end, he's caught. But I think his little picture of the building is...
But similar to what you gave us.
Yeah, they all kind of look the same. Not the same, but that's, you know.
That's what you
get. It's
the
coloring that changes everything on those. If you pick a nice, mellow color.
And then all your accessories, your skylights, and your
beautiful. Well, there's also
and your windows.
Depending on, but in terms of, you can condition certain materials, like the whatever is needed in terms of the pitch and the roof. Certain design features could be conditioned without...
Well, we actually submitted the cross section, so you have the pitch.
Well, that's a pre-engineered building. That's going to meet, as long as they meet all the...
Right, as long as they meet building code.
So what was the height at the...
That's right.
Is it 22 at the peak?
Right,
17 at the shoulders?
22 at the peak, 17 at the eaves, yeah.
Okay.
And again, we did submit that, so that is in the file.
It's long gray.
It's well within the town's height.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it just... That's really not our purview.
Yeah.
So we're just thinking of snow load.
Visually, it
in
is.
The winter.
What happens if we say the intent of the project is good, and he's got some things that he has to...
Exactly. That's why we have another hearing.
And it comes
I'm not saying we're going to drag this out for umpteen hearings, right? I'm more worried about, you know, and I think John is well aware of what he needs to do with BMPs for stormwater, for his own, too.
And I
mean, he's got the right engineer who's on top of that.
And I'd like to just go over Larry's reports again.
Exactly, especially the new one. You know, we just got
comments.
That today,
mm-hmm.
which I think it's narrowed down. You're kind of ahead of the game. I mean, this was
this was
the opening of the hearing, and you already have two responses from Mr.
Right.
Grant.
Yeah, I
our
can't.
Review engineer. That's way ahead of the game.
Yeah, no, it sounds like it. Yeah, way out in front of it.
Yeah, we were lucky. Kirk got the, you know, the plans into Larry before, right around when he had the meeting scheduled, and Larry was gracious enough to get us a review before. You know, we even had the first meeting.
Which is, yeah, I was kind of...
And there wasn't a whole lot of heavy lifting to be done to address his comments.
And you were very fast about turning around the first set to narrow it down to the second set.
Yeah, and now I don't think there's really a whole lot on there that needs a whole lot to be addressed. It's more, I think, what the board wants to address.
I'll just move to continue it to the next hearing.
Before we do that, though, can I just address one thing? Somebody brought up parking. I think it was David.
Yeah.
With regards to parking, again, he's not having customers come to his site.
It's not a retail site.
We don't want to stripe the parking lot because he may find, after he's here for 6 months, he may want to park his vehicles in a different way, and now all of a sudden he's got stripes all over the place.
I don't think it applies.
But what I can, I don't either, because it's not really
It does, but it doesn't.
What we've got is we've got almost six spaces just right across the front of the building, which nobody's going to park there anyway. The only guy parking up in the front is going to be Jim, and he's going to park up on the side. It'll leave these other two doors wide open. He's got four employee parking. We have enough parallel spacing that they can park right along here. And the reason for that is we get the bark mulch stockpiled here, or in the winter, you get your snow pile stocked right here. The rest of his vehicles all park here. And by leaving this open, as they come in, then they can back out.
And I'd rather not see a jumble of parking unscreened. Well, these car, be, I can't believe I'm saying that after what's next to you. I mean, really.
Yeah.
But these will be, this will be screened. It's behind the building. It'll be screened through here, and we'll figure out what to do with the fence on this edge to screen that view coming in that way as well.
You know, you can even, I don't know, a slatted chain.
Well, as long as it's screened from the street and landscaping on that
side. Yeah, think about what
it's only the stockpiles we're trying to screen, right?
And also, I noticed, even on that future marijuana dispensary, believe it or not, there's a wall pack when you go west on 133. Did you see? Right in your eyes. It's really, really bright.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it's like right.
It goes back right, to the printing.
Right in your face.
Yeah, that's and where the
you see how bright. So
be.
you don't want something on that building that could do the same thing that people driving on 133 right now.
Right.
Well, all he's got is a door over the door light on that side.
Yeah, on this side.
You'll see what I mean, John. Go towards that, and if you're ever at night, just watch. And luckily, there's a few trees that kind of break it up, some pines.
They're changing those.
Yeah, I know they've changed them out. But you know the one idea? That's really bright. Yeah, so that I'm not saying that will stay, because if it did, it's not really the right thing to have when
right.
people are driving down a road.
All right, so pretty much, I mean, I know we've got to look at the landscaping and look at what to do with the fence and the landscaping. With regards to the building, I believe that what I'm hearing from the board is that the architectural or the information we've submitted with regards to the architectural is sufficient. And I think that's really it.
In Larry's comments, I think Larry might be remiss in a zone two, as you know. How come you haven't mentioned the fact you're supposed to get a special permit?
We're actually working on that.
At this time, the town has, for some reason, at this time, because of the way the watershed protection bylaw was written many years ago, when they were developing the wells in town, but it hasn't really been updated. The ZBA is supposed to give you the zone.
Right. Two. When Kirk and I met in January going over what permits were required and what we needed to file, there was a little confusion of whether we needed to file for that or not, even though when you read the zoning bylaw, it's pretty evident that you need a special permit because of the fact that we're over 2,500 square feet of impervious. So a few weeks ago, Kirk and I talked about it again. And I had informed him that, look, I'm just going to file the special permit with the zoning board. The zoning board actually moved their meeting. It was supposed to be submitted by this Monday, but they moved their meeting in April, so we don't have to submit until next Monday. But we will be submitting the special permit application with the zoning board.
Yeah, it's too bad it kind of couldn't be one-stop shopping. You know?
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Doesn't that make more sense?
Well, given that we're
since we're doing
thing,
stormwater
yeah.
management?
Yep.
Yeah.
And we could have done a special permit with, but we're not, the planning board's not the special permit granting agency.
But it seems like that's just one of these things.
I mean, it might be
but that's
something
not
to
do with you guys.
About
just
someday.
From an efficient getting you guys, you know, be able for you to go through more quickly.
Definitely.
Well, we do some special permits.
Yeah.
But right.
But we don't do one in the zone, too.
The planning board does, like, floodplain permits.
Yeah. So they could switch it over and give you guys the authority.
We got the soil. We got the floodplain. You know, we took some of the ones from the selectmen to put them in a centralized planning board.
Should have this one.
Maybe this is one that might.
So you're okay with continuing this meeting until
yes.
We're talking about April 27th for a follow-up date. Is that too far out?
No, I mean, we've got.
It's not too far out if we can maybe put it to bed if we have everything.
Right, and we have conservation on the 26th. We've actually met with conservation twice. They're actually all set. The only reason I left the conservation meeting open is because I didn't want to close it without coming before planning. Mm-hmm. So now that I've been before planning, I'll talk to my client. We may be at a comfort level now that we'll just ask the CONCOM to close their public hearing at the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, no, I take it back. CONCOM changed their meeting. They're meeting the second week in April.
Okay.
So I may decide to keep their meeting open still, but again, they're pretty much finished. They don't have any additional comments.
Well, Kirk can talk to Brent.
Yep.
When was the ZBA meeting?
End of April. I think it's, you're saying you're doing the 27th?
Yeah.
I believe they're the 28th.
Okay.
The one thing that the planning board would have to consider is if you want to, you would be okay doing a decision letter, a site plan review condition approval condition letter, where you make it a condition that they get a special permit approval from the Zoning Board of Appeals, you know, prior to getting a building permit, or you could, I guess, keep the hearing open until the.
But you'll know that.
I mean, the final letter could not say be released until after.
It's kind of one of those things where you don't want so many conditions.
Yeah.
But right, it'll put us in a position where if we have a draft decision for the next meeting, that you know, typically we want you to review it ahead of the meeting.
Right.
Right? So the proponent can review it. Otherwise, it doesn't go anywhere in the meeting. And if it's conditioned on the conservation, on these other boards, as Larry's recommendation on his March 30th letter, is that the way you want to keep it? I mean,
I think
we're fine with that.
Okay.
Given that you'll know in a day.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, it's either that or you go to our next meeting, which would be at least 2 weeks out from that.
Right. So, I mean, we'd rather just get
it. Because the thing about closing it is that then the clock ticks, and then because we have to sign and vote on it, you know, we vote to close it, and then we sign the decision. It's better to get it closed.
Right. Exactly. It gets the ball rolling.
Between appeals and all the other stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right, so the meeting is the next meeting is the 27th?
Got a time?
That's still a time to straighten. They're working on this.
8:30?
So
yeah, I guess it's 8:30
because we're doing
it. Yeah, whenever the time is.
And they got time for that.
Mm-hmm.
And Kirk, so it's not a last-minute glitch. Chris brought a really good point. Make sure that easement stuff is taken care of.
Yes. Yep, we can get that wrapped up before your meeting, and we'll get the information.
That's a good point.
And just send Kirk a copy of the proposed easement deed.
Actually, we'll send them the recorded. It'll just be the recorded document.
Gotcha.
It doesn't need anyone's approval, so we'll get it done, get it recorded. Yeah, we'll get it to you, Larry. Yep.
Can I make a motion? Make a motion and we continue the hearing to the April 27th.
At 8 o'clock?
8:30. We have one at 8 already.
Oh, we do?
First thing we had to do tonight,
8:30. Sounds good?
Somebody second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good. Another motion to end this meeting?
Motion.
You got anything else to
add? Mark moved, second.
Make it quick, hurry up.
Got any notes? Anything?
Larry,
I guess the.
Did you pay checks?
We have a vote to end the meeting.
No, we each got something to say.
Oh, yeah, he's got something to
do. Make it quick.
I did want to, like.
What's he think? He's a planner or something?
I did actually a ZBA. I mean, I can send this stuff to you. But I did a ZBA case review of 804 behavioral and SIT comments. Actually, that's John's project as well. And but then there was also, we've actually had discussions about 317, 321 Haverhill Street before, the bookstore is. And there's been some interest.
Good night, John.
Several.
Thank you.
Good night, John.
Inquiries into what, you know, like one is a salon that people are asking about. Another.
I believe it's an existing salon. It's already in town.
Yeah. Another is a dog training. There's a lady, and I'll send this around for you guys to look at. We can talk about it at the next meeting. But she submitted a plan, you know, a business plan with details, and I'll just forward this around so everyone can look at it for next time. And then another thing was the veterans, VFW over here on Bradford. They're looking to actually. And they were going to do this last year, but then I guess
you know, just for some reason weren't able to get it, you know, get the stuff in to for us to look at. But they were looking to, in the very back of the building, they want to put a couple of seats, like two tables and some chairs for outdoor seating, only really during the summer months or spring summer months. It's supposed to be temporary, but they were wanting to do, and I don't know that we should really make this a full site plan approval, but maybe to look at, see what, if we could work with them to have something that's on a temporary basis where they bring some drawings.
They need some drawings to define the area because...
Yeah, which actually...
You could probably have a liquor license issue in there too, right? They're going to serve beer and wine. Or,
yeah, but I'm sure they're aware of that.
Yeah, actually...
You need to define that by...
I can actually show you...
In Salem all the time.
That's a good idea.
Some of the... Which one? I'm in the...
It looks like a bomb explosion or something like that.
Oh, that was the part of the lighting display. Yeah. I'm in the wrong
side. North Korea.
Yeah.
Yeah,
please. Oh my God.
Let's see. Here's the drawing that they actually wanted to.
Man, it's just a little seasonal thing, so what?
Yeah, that may be good enough.
As long as they comply with what the liquor deal.
Yeah, so this is behind the building. Really what's going to be, you know how big this parking lot is? There's like tons of parking back there.
There is.
It's in the back of the building towards the middle.
It's only two 16, tables and eight chairs.
Yeah, a 16 by 12 that's area right. That's going to take up the area of two parking spaces that are back there. So for that temporary time, they would lose the two parking spaces, but they got plenty of parking out there. And
they're doing it in run.
This is true.
I think the main thing is that they want to put like some kind of temporary barrier, you know, maybe some kind of decorative.
But how can we deal with it short of a site plan? I mean, I think as much as
this could be
just have Kirk.
That's like a site
the zoning,
plan.
And if we can vote on it within the zoning.
Yeah, maybe I could.
Look at the context of the rules.
They could use bollards and little looping chains.
Well, that's what he's kind of proposing to do, bollards and loop
like
and chains. Something just to designate the area. And they said they for safety reasons they could put in if the board would prefer.
This is could be a major upgrade for the VFW here.
Could change their whole.
All right. Let's
that's what they're doing. I didn't.
Kirk, okay. Oh, Kirk, next.
I need to advise the board of it, but like.
Kirk, it's getting late, and you're talking about two tables and four chairs.
I'm just right. saying
okay,
that
now.
That
really, who made that motion?
That if you're okay with it, I can work with them to.
Yes.
I think we should. Yeah, absolutely.
Make something like this possible.
Somebody come in and present it. That's.
Yeah.
Just
and
look at it in the context
thing,
of the zoning.
Away.
So we're voting on something according to the zoning. That's all.
Yeah.
I make a motion we adjourn.
Didn't we adjourn already?
No.
Can we have a second on that?
Second.
All in favor?
Thanks for coming, Mark.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Who was the second?
Late one. All right.